So good afternoon, everyone. It's great to see you all here. And it is my pleasure, on behalf of many people who you will meet during the course of this symposium, to welcome you here for this party slash symposium to launch our book, The Practice of Reproducible Research. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Justin Kitzes. I'm a postdoc scholar in the Energy and Resources Group here, and also a data science fellow at BIDS, Berkeley Institute for Data Science. Right off the bat, I want to introduce two other people who are Fatma Dennis here in the front, and Daniel Turek, who are the other two editors for the book. Fatma is a postdoc in neuroscience and also a data science fellow in BIDS. Daniel is a former data science fellow in BIDS and now professor, assistant professor of statistics at Williams College. As I said, the three of us were the kind of editors or compilers of the book today, but we're also fortunate to have many other folks who were part of the core team who helped to write these chapters and put the book together, and you'll meet many of them as we go through today. So now, right off the bat, in the interest of not burying the lead, as they say, but at the risk of sending you all to your phones and laptops, I'm going to put this URL up right now. So this is the book itself. This is the open online version of the book. You are welcome to read it, of course, and share it. Please share it widely if you would like. For those of you who prefer print versions of books, print publishing runs just a tiny bit slower than the internet does. So print versions of the book will be out from UC Press this fall. So if you are interested in the print version, just keep an eye on the BIDS website. It'll announce when the print versions are available for purchase also. Now, for those of you who would prefer to hear about the book rather than just reading it, which I hope is all of you, that's why we're here today. So I'm going to start off by just telling you a little bit about the project that led to the book and, of course, the book itself as a way of introducing you to what you'll find in it. And after that, I'm going to turn over to several of the other folks who've been deeply involved to go into more detail about what you'll find here, what we learned from the process of this project, and what you might learn from reading the book as well. So to start off, the very beginning here, oh, this is the book. See you shortly. But to start off, I want to say that this book owes its genesis really in nearly every respect to these funders, to the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation and the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation. So about 3-4 years ago, these foundations got together to make a serious financial and intellectual commitment to supporting data science research and activities, particularly at UC Berkeley, the University of Washington, and NYU. And here at Berkeley, the funds from this grant were used, among other things, to launch up the Berkeley Institute for Data Science, which, as most of you know, is over in 190 Doe Library. Now, one of the first things that BIDS did was to bring in a crop of fellows. And these were students, staff, and postdocs already here on campus. They were brought in for joint appointments with the Data Science Institute. And this first group of fellows actually included all three of us who ended up editing this book, in addition to many of the other core contributors. And it was through BIDS that we met, got together, and sort of hatched the idea for putting this project together. So, of course, we're in the Bay Area, so as traditional for projects that launch in the Bay Area, we always have to be the X of Y, right? So you have to be like the Uber of food, right? Or like the LinkedIn of Kazakhstan, or like something like that. So in that spirit, we actually, towards the beginning, we're thinking about this book called Beautiful Code, which some of you may know. So this book contains a relatively large number of essays written by software designers who describe a particular example of code that they wrote in detail and talked about why, in this case, they found it to be beautiful or particularly interesting. So in other words, this book was thinking about teaching how to think about how to write good code by example, the same way that architects would learn how to do architecture by examining buildings that had already been built, right? And so in short, we started off thinking about this project as producing a collection which you could call something like Beautiful Code for Reproducibility. That is, we wanted to collect a similar set of real-world, very concrete examples of scientists attempting to make their work more reproducible. Now, of course, before I say any more about reproducibility, I should say something about what that word means. So, of course, there are several different definitions that people would use of the word reproducibility, but for the purposes of the book, this was the operational definition we were working with most of the time, which we were arguing was sort of the basic, foundational, bottom type of reproducibility to deal with, which we referred to as computational reproducibility. So this is up here, but in short, it's the idea that you did a project, ran a study, and produced some result. figure, table, number. A project is computationally reproducible if you could give something, a set of instructions, a set of files, a set of data, to someone else, and they could reproduce, recreate, or get back the same answer that you got. So this is very basic and very foundational, of course. And there are other ways of thinking about reproducibility, which are actually covered in great detail in chapter 2 of the book, Assessing Reproducibility. So you may be interested in that as well. So if we wanted to be the beautiful code of reproducibility, how would we go about that? Well, true to the inspiration, we decided to gather case studies. They became contributed case study chapters in the book itself from practicing academic researchers, specifically in the data-intensive sciences. And of course, given the relationship, the location where we are right now, and the relationships between the data science institutes, most of these case studies ended up coming from Berkeley, NYU, and the University of Washington from those initiatives. To keep those case studies somewhat consistent from author to author, we actually gave authors a template to follow. And I won't say too much about that other than to say that it helps to make them more readable and more comparable to each other. You can kind of flip through the same structure from chapter to chapter and see how different authors responded to the same types of questions. And Daniel's going to come up right after this and talk a little more about that. And after Daniel, in fact, we'll hear some examples of some of the case studies from the book. Now, I'll note at this point, when thinking about case studies, and other speakers will stress this as well, that these case studies aren't always success stories per se. These aren't just stories about how great everything went. Just as important as the successes, these chapters describe the different challenges, partial successes, partial failures, difficulties that the authors encountered in trying to work towards the goal of making their research reproducible. And those are aspects that you'll find in all of these case study chapters as well. Now, finally, for those of you whose eyes are glazing over a bit at the thought of reading through all 31 of our brilliant, but not entirely short, case studies that you would find in the book, we did have a core group of authors who took it upon themselves to put together a synthesis and summary of the chapters themselves, which you'll find in part one of the book. And these are the sections of that. So following an introduction, you'll find this first, the chapter that I mentioned just a few minutes ago about assessing and defining reproducibility, followed by an example of a very simple, basic template for a reproducible workflow, small scale, single investigator project, tabular data. This is a particularly good place to start. You can see there's kitses thereafter. This is a particularly good place to start, I would say, in my humble opinion, especially if you're a beginning investigator and just wondering, how do I think about this workflow process in a way that I can get started? That's a good place to start. Following that, we have a chapter that sort of summarizes the basic characteristics across all the case studies, and then the lessons learned chapter, which tries to synthesize sort of what we took away. So not just what we found in the chapters, but what we took away as lessons for today and for the future. We close off the book with a chapter specifically about where we go from here, and then a glossary, which is actually much more than a glossary. It's an extended sort of discussion and annotated list of tools, methods, terms that you'll come across within thinking about reproducibility. So that's basically what the book looks like. Parts 2 and 3, of course, have the actual case studies themselves. Now, as you might expect, unsurprisingly, the rest of what we'll talk about today with you follows pretty closely the structure of the book. You just were introduced from me, and coming up next is going to be Daniel Turk, who's going to give a description of the case studies themselves in a little more detail. Following that, we have 4 brief lightning talks, which are going to present the information found in some of the case studies. We have 2 authors from Berkeley and 2 from the University of Washington. They're representing the disciplines of economics, statistics, neuroscience, and archaeology, which gives you a sense for some of the breadth of the authors that we did actually have contributing chapters to the book as well. Then we're going to have Katie Huff describing some of those take-home lessons learned, and Karthik Ram giving the way forward. At the end, we did leave a good amount of time also to have a discussion. So we'll bring some chairs up here, we'll sit up here, and hopefully we can have a little bit of a talk about what we talked about and reproducibility more generally.
As you mentioned, my name is Daniel Turek, and I'll be discussing the basic features of the case studies. This will include both the process of collecting them, how we came about to get this collection, and then also summarizing some of the main trends and statistics about the actual case studies themselves. So, as Justin mentioned, this entire initiative came out of originally the Reproducibility Working Group, a small subset of that, at BIDS. A number of us, the core contributors and authors, decided to actually undertake this project together. And that started in bids with us sitting down and discussing what actually a case study would look like, what we thought these should appear as. So we, as you mentioned, put together what we called the case study template to provide some standardization across all the case studies. It's pretty straightforward, you can see here, consists of a couple of major parts, an introduction with biographical information about the author, and then also an opportunity for authors to sort of describe their discipline and area of research to provide context and set the stage for their actual reproducible workflow. Then there's the core sections of the workflow, consisting of two parts, one the workflow diagram, and second a narrative. The diagram is essentially a flow chart showing the end-to-end pipeline of the reproducible workflow, where boxes in the flow chart represent tools used, intermediate products, data sets, perhaps scripts, or the various steps of the process, and the arrows or connections between those, obviously showing the flow of information and the process itself. This diagram is intended to go hand in hand with the workflow narrative, the other major section, which essentially gave the authors an opportunity to walk a reader through their workflow diagram, explaining things in more detail than is possible in the diagram itself. And also, as we know, no workflow or no research process is really without problems and hiccups. So in the narrative, they're intended to explain the difficult points, where they had to backtrack, what the problems were, and also explaining, for example, the time required for the different steps, things which are not shown in the diagram itself. These core sections were then complemented by several sort of summary sections listed here, the pain points, the benefits, and tools. Now, the information for those summary points is also intended, probably appears in the narrative itself, but having those appear together, consolidated at the end, would give the authors an opportunity to focus on those and bring that information together. So readers, for example, rather than parsing through the entire narrative, could go ahead and digest quickly, see what, say, the main tools or the key benefits from a particular workflow were. So having that all concisely at the end. And finally, there were several optional questions at the end of the template, general questions about reproducibility. Optional for the authors, but once again, asking sorts of questions such as why reproducibility is important, what the major incentives they see for reproducible research are, the tools they used, and how they came to learn about reproducibility, et cetera. So depending on the answers to those, subsets of those questions were included in the final book as well. So with this template in hand, we then set out to collect the case studies. And as Justin mentioned, we ended up with a collection of 31 case studies, largely contributed from the partner data science initiatives here at Berkeley BIDS, obviously, the New York University Center, and also the eScience Institute at University of Washington, largely from those three centers for data science. And also one major milestone we had for collecting case studies was actually a small workshop, a reproducibility workshop hosted here at BIDS back in May of 2015, in which one of the sessions we hosted gave participants an opportunity to draft a case study with members of the Reproducibility Working Group there to guide them, peer reviews, editing in real time, et cetera. So we got a large number of contributions from there, after which authors could take their case study home, continue revisions, and do a final submission to appear in the book. So as we started to receive these case studies, we started to look over them and noticed that essentially most of the flowcharts, so the diagrams, could be broken down into one of three major stages. Stage one, data input, stage two, consisting of processing, and stage three, the analysis of the data. As the names imply, stage one is wherever the data came from, be it collecting it oneself, scraping it from the web, or sometimes as well simulated data, but the output being a raw data product going into stage two, where the processing takes place, the cleaning of the data set, and then that product flowing into stage three, the analysis of the data, drawing conclusions, and we included in that stage the output of the workflow, be it a manuscript or software, et cetera. So having identified these three major stages, which most of the flowcharts could break into, this provided a means for what we called a natural classification of the case studies into one of two categories. High-level case studies we defined as describing all three of these stages, the input, the processing, and the analysis. And then low-level case studies we defined as just describing a subset of these stages. For example, just focusing on stage three data analysis. And as the names also imply, the high-level case studies, having a much broader picture of the entire pipeline, generally were at a much higher level of detail, providing less technical information, less nitty-gritty details of the implementation, whereas low-level case studies focusing on a much more narrow section of that pipeline, therefore oftentimes provide much more technical detail. So we thought this was a nice breakdown, and actually this high-level and low-level classification persists into the book. As you saw in the outline Justin gave, they're actually separated into two sections, the high-level studies and the low-level studies. So with this classification in hand, it lets us take a look at the breakdown of case studies across these various contexts. The high-level case studies, there are 21 of these focusing on all three stages of the pipeline, and the remaining 10 were the low-level case studies. And we can see how this falls apart between the three stages. On the right there, the 21 of them covering all three stages, and then among the 10 low-level case studies, four of those focusing just on stage three, data analysis. Two of them with data processing, and the others you can see there with a small number of the case studies focusing on two of the three stages. So it's interesting actually to see what people doing modern reproducible research, how they envision their workflow and their pipeline as what stages of this it focuses on. Also interesting was to look at the disciplines represented by the case studies here. So this quickly just gives the primary discipline represented by each of the case studies. Two major, you know, interesting observations here. One, as Justin alluded to, the breadth of the disciplines represented in the case studies. It's not a very narrow segment of academic research or one primary field. It's actually a wide breadth of academic research areas. And the second thing you might note here is that there is a slight tendency, you know, representation of the core sciences or perhaps the STEM-related fields, the largest representation being in areas of mathematics and statistics, then things such as neuroscience, computer science, environmental science, etc. So largely these sort of sciences represented, but a wide representation in any case. And finally, looking at all the case studies, we also can observe some very high-level trends among the case studies themselves, which really gives us some good insight as to what modern reproducible practices, the things people are doing these days. One of the most prominent trends among the case studies was the existence of version control, and more specifically, now currently the use of Git and or GitHub for people doing their version control. 80% of the case studies, people were using Git or GitHub for their version control. About 10 or 15%, unfortunately, had no mention of version control whatsoever. And then the remaining couple percent there used something else for version control, for example, Mercurial we saw, or SVN. So this is one of the strongest trends. Another one we noticed was the importance of open, publicly available data. 60% of the case studies either exclusively made use of open data or in the process of the workflow described actually made their data publicly available. So this is obviously another trend we see here, and I think it's, you know, increasing with the emphasis on transparency and reproducibility these days in scientific research. Also can consider the primary languages being used here. Now, obviously, all the case studies make use of many different tools and languages, but just considering the primary language used for computation or analysis, we saw over half of the case studies making use of Python. Very understandable. You know, people really appreciate the IPython notebook, makes it very popular, and also the readability and quick development cycle available with Python, so no surprise there. Following that was R, just over a third of the case studies, and I myself subscribe to that, it being the primary environment for statisticians to use, and also the large libraries of user-contributed packages available make R very popular these days. And then finally, the remaining 13% make use of a wide variety of other languages, not even worth trying to list here, but among others, yeah, for example, Julia, C, C++, MATLAB, Java, JavaScript, among many others. So a wide variety in that remaining 13%. And a final observation about the case studies is just the output of what these reproducible workflows were producing. This largely probably because they're drawn from areas of academics, but almost all of the case studies did result in scientific publication or a manuscript for publication. That was almost universal, but in addition to that, perhaps more interesting, a large number of the case studies actually produced software products intended for larger use, or the creating a workflow itself that other people were intended to use, for example, for data cleaning or for analysis, something like that. So those are the major outputs we observed. So with that, I'll stop here. It gives a reasonably good idea of the case studies, where they came from, and some of the major trends. And we'll move on to several of the lightning talks about the case studies so you can see these in practice. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. My name is Ariel Roquem. I'm a data scientist at the University of Washington eScience Institute, and I'll tell you today about this case study. I joined the University of Washington eScience Institute in March of 2015, pretty much just in time to join that May meeting in 2015. At the time, I had just finished a postdoc at Stanford University working in the lab of Brian Wandel, and we had just published a paper on a neuroscience topic, and that is the topic of our study is the white matter. These are these brain superhighways that connect different parts of the brain. Here, an exposed track of white matter connecting the center of the brain, the thalamus, to the visual cortex in the back. And the method that we used relies on the fact that when you look at these nerve fibers, water can diffuse along the length of these nerve fibers much more readily than across their membranes. And we use that in MRI to measure the diffusion of water in vivo in humans inside of an MRI machine. So this these pictures here are slices through, this is a slice, horizontal slice through pretty much the middle of the brain. And as I'm rotating around this thing, the gradient, the magnetic field gradient, is rotating through this magnet and sensitizing the measurement to diffusion in different directions. And that's called diffusion MRI. And we can use that in order to make inferences about these white matter connections and to build computational models using a method called tractography that connect the diffusion of water in different parts of the brain together into these wires that estimate the connections that exist inside of the white matter. Now, the first step in doing this process is a model in each one of the voxels, or these are sort of volumetric pixels in the MRI image. Here you see 150 measurements in 150 different directions of diffusion gradients. And the distance from the center of this cloud is how much diffusion there is in different directions. And a typical thing to do is to estimate some kind of model, a simple model of this diffusion. For example, this model called the diffusion tensor model estimates a three-dimensional Gaussian distribution of diffusion in different directions within this voxel. This is this this rank 2 tensor here in the middle. But a question arises, and one that isn't really asked a lot in this field, strangely enough, is which model should we use for a particular data set? Say I've made some measurement. Which model should I use? There are many different models in the literature, and you might ask which model fits the data more accurately. And that's exactly what we did. And in this paper that we published in PLOS in early 2015, we suggested that researchers can use cross-validation. You can measure this measurement once, you can fit the model, and then you can try to predict another measurement using this. And you can compare that to test-retest reliability, which gives you a natural scale for estimating whether the model is good. Here we're simply comparing three different measurements with different diffusion weightings, two different models, the diffusion tensor model that I showed you, and an alternative that we proposed here called the sparse fascicle model, which is a variant on a model that's quite popular in the literature. Okay, so this served as the basis for the case study. Here is the big Rube Goldberg machine that produced that. So you can see the paper down here in the corner, plus one. That was where the paper appeared. We had it actually deposited in an archive before. But in between, up here on the left top corner, is the MRI scanner where the data came from. And the data goes through one process, and there's computational processes that happen here, including some pretty big computers down at Stanford. And an important part of this work was, as mentioned, Git and GitHub, and the development of a software library that I named Osmosis, because osmosis is not diffusion, and that was written in Python and created the visualizations and simulations and the figures that went into the paper. So every figure had an IPython notebook that appeared in a documentation folder inside a folder that was named figures, and eventually that that folder contained all of the notebooks. Now, one of the challenges is that is actually sustaining this kind of reproducibility, right? I was working by myself on this big library of stuff, and I created a lot of stuff that isn't useful to anyone, and I created some stuff that it may be only useful to me. Distilling out and sustaining this reproducibility is really, really hard. One way to do that is to take whatever is developed by the single hero developer that tries to control everything in whatever they do, and try to incorporate that in a larger community context. So a lot of this work went eventually into a more broader community-based development project, which is called DIPI, Diffusion Imaging in Python. I tried to distill out whatever was useful from this and put it into this library that we maintain as a collaborative community. And so this is from the documentation of this package. You have this cross-validation for model comparison that went into eventually into this software package. And I think that's a good model for sustaining reproducibility over time. Another kind of challenge that appears here is this HPC cluster. Not everyone has one in their lab or in their university. How do we make large computations, large and complex computational workflows available to other researchers? And so the solution to that has now come in the form of developments that I've done since. As mentioned in the introduction, a lot of the data, we made data available publicly, but there are actually projects that are creating these large brain observatories and making a lot of data publicly available for any researcher. For example, the Human Connectome Project, an NIH-funded project, is making available more than 1,000 individual measurements of diffusion MRI, and anyone can download these data and analyze them. And we were interested in doing cross-validation, this kind of model comparison, on 900 different brains. Now, 900 different brains using K-fold cross-validation is a lot of computation. And the way that we scale that up is using Apache Spark on Amazon Web Services. And this also allows us to be reproducible in the sense that if you click on the link here, that will take you to the GitHub repository that then allows you to enter your Amazon Web Service credentials and run this at the same scale. Okay, and with that, I will end. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So my paper is on the title of the actual paper that underlies the workflow is called Occupational Deaths and the Labor Supply, Evidence from the Wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. And so I'm Garrett Christensen. I'm at BIDS and also Berkeley Initiative for Transparency in the Social Sciences. So I try to think about this reproducibility stuff a lot. And the question for this research paper is whether this first slide or the next one that I'll show you is more common. This guy on the far right, that's Bill Krissoff, an orthopedic surgeon who was 61 years old when he enlisted in the Navy Medical Corps after his son, Nathan, to his right, on your left, was killed in the Marine Corps in Iraq in 2006. Obviously, under normal circumstances, people who are 61 are not allowed to enlist in the military, but this guy deliberately signed up as a result of a death. Whereas you might think that other deaths, for example, Pat Tillman's death by friendly fire that was miscommunicated or obfuscated by the administration, that perhaps led to fewer people signing up for the military as a result of deaths. So my question is the recruiting response to deaths in the military and how I organized this workflow. I had to get data from a lot of sources, including through Freedom of Information Act requests to the Office of the Secretary of Defense. And so that's for the recruiting data, and then data for deaths was actually publicly available, as well as a whole bunch of other demographic and sort of geographic characteristics. Got a bunch of data. I do all my put it all together, do all my data cleaning. I'm an economist. Most of us do all our work in Stata, and wrote the paper in LaTeX. And of course, as you can see in there's lots of feedback between once I've got the data, start analyzing it and say, oh, I should probably be controlling for this as well. Go get the data, do it again, and then start writing the paper and say, no, somebody says, go get some more data, or that's the wrong type of analysis, do this instead. So lots of feedback in these loops. And write a paper, and just an hour ago, I finally got a revise and resubmit on this paper. So, and I started it 6 years ago. So, sort of some of my issues and pain points. I am at the mercy of the Office of Secretary of Defense. A friend of mine actually filed the very first FOIA in something like 2005, 2004 or 5. We got the first data in 2006. You submit a FOIA, and if you're like me and don't have a lawyer, you get a response in 3 weeks saying, we're not going to comply with the statutory 2-week timeline. Instead, we're going to put you in line. There are currently 1,800 people in line. Good luck. And so then a year and a half later, you get a CD in the mail, and then 6 months after that, your friends who still live at that old place where you used to live realize, oh, they should probably give you that CD. So 2 years later, you get some data. So I use Stata, which is proprietary, but I wrote the paper in LaTeX. I When I started, I wasn't great at LaTeX, so I actually did some of the table work in tuning the tables in Excel, but in the latest version, I cut that out. This is causal inference from observational data. I have longitudinal data, county, monthly data. So I use fixed effects, but and you know there are parallel trends assumptions built into that. Economists do this sort of stuff all the time. I think there's no way on earth that anyone starting from scratch with my data would come up with the exact same models. Even though I can reproduce my work because I've had to do it for 6 years and go back to it, I can actually with one click get the same numbers again. But somebody else working independently, I don't think they would choose to do this exact same analysis. So I started in 2010. I learned Git in 2015. So originally I was doing a lot of save as with dates, and I have had to go through those files a lot and opening 20 different versions to see when on what date I made a change, and it got the job done. But now it's all in GitHub. So okay, so my conclusions, as far as the paper goes, potential military recruits are deterred from enlistment by local deaths on the order of 1%, local meaning a death of a soldier from your home county, but not by deaths from more distant locales. I can't verify the completeness of the raw data, so I asked the Office of the Secretary of Defense for the entire universe of enlistees. But I have no, I am not allowed to run the SQL request on the Defense Manpower Data Center server, so I don't know, and there's no way to verify that. I can largely reproduce my results, but as I said, I doubt anyone would independently choose the same models I came up with. And as far as the data now, I got it through a FOIA request, but now the data is all up on Dataverse and the code's all on GitHub. And that's it.
All right, thanks. So I'm Kelly. I am a third year PhD student in statistics and I'm a BIDS fellow here. So when this project was started, I was a first year and I decided to write about sort of the first project I really worked on as a grad student. And I was just getting my feet wet in the whole reproducible workflow. So this was a collaboration with my advisor, Philip Stark, who wrote, I think, the preface to this book, and some researchers in public health. And what we wanted to ask was, after we control for known predictors of bad health outcomes, so namely alcohol and smoking, does salt consumption have an effect on 30-year life expectancy? And all our data was aggregate at the level of nations, gender specific. So we couldn't really do causal inference per se, but we wanted to look at this correlation. And in doing so, we were testing out a new permutation method that we were working on at the time. So this work sort of had two threads. The first was the statistical methods part, and the other was actually looking at this data. So here's my workflow diagram. The first part was really just sitting down and thinking about what we were gonna do before ever touching the data. Like, how should we approach this problem and address it with the method we're working on? The second was actually getting our hands dirty with the code, and namely writing the code to do these statistical methods, which I put in an R package on GitHub. So doing the R package thing is really nice for myself, putting it into a clean format where I can test it and document it, and also putting it out there for others to use. And finally came the data work, actually doing the analysis, visualizing results, writing it up, and then putting both the data and all the analyses on GitHub. And what ended up happening was, you run the analysis, like Garrett said, you realize you did something kind of fishy or you need more data. And so it ended up being an iterative process where we actually went back to the start and collected more data as we went. So the key tools that I used were RStudio. So I'm a statistician, a lot of us work in R. And RStudio has some really nice integration for documentation and making R packages. So I relied heavily on those. And also version control, I use Git and GitHub. But that wasn't perfect. So when you're doing statistical analyses or any kind of analysis, you want to keep track of the decisions you're making, not just the actual files themselves. And so I found myself trying to come up with ways to sort of version control my analysis and really clearly document the decisions I was making. So I thought that Knitter and RStudio were actually pretty useful for doing this. One thing that everyone I talk to seems to have trouble with is getting our collaborators on board with using reproducible tools. It's partly just a cultural thing. You know, if their field isn't using this heavily, then they're not going to probably. And what I ended up doing a lot of the time was I would make changes to the documents, push it to GitHub, and then have to send them a PDF anyway. And finally, I mentioned we had to go back and collect more data. We, you know, it was in like PDFs of papers. We could have written scripts to do it, but it wasn't that much data, so we just hand entered it. And unfortunately, that step is not reproducible. But so it wasn't perfect, but I think statisticians in particular need to think about working in this way more often. Reproducibility often gets blamed on statisticians because we don't, you know, it's always the statistical analysis that's wrong. So if we can do our best to explain what's going on, then people can poke holes in it, but they can't say that we're sweeping things under the rug. I think it's critical for my own efficiency. I'm just being selfish, but it helps me work a lot faster and keep track of what I'm doing. And finally, if we're developing new methods, might as well put them out there for people to use. Otherwise, what's the point if it's just sitting in a paper and nobody knows what to do with it? So I think it's critical. Yeah, that's it. Thanks.
I just want to give a few personal reflections on the event that we came to that led to the formation of the book, and then a little bit of detail about my case study and sort of where I come from there. So I'm an archaeologist. I work at the University of Washington. I'm currently an associate professor, but at the time I came to this workshop where we came together to write this chapter, I was an assistant professor. So between then and now, I got tenure, and I got a major research fellowship that has allowed me to do some quite different things. So it's been quite a sort of lot of personal and professional change for me between then and now. And so I feel like I've got some sort of good perspective to cast my mind back on what it was like then. At that point, participating in a workshop was quite an exotic experience for me, because in my community we rarely do anything with any kind of code, and we don't really talk a lot with people from other disciplines either. So this was, I was doing something with code, which was my sort of secret hobby at the time anyway. And then I'm spending some time here speaking to people in many other disciplines that I sort of knew from the internet or from things they published, but hadn't really spoken face to face and hadn't sort of seen the fear in their eyes when they're talking about their own work and the challenges they face and so on. So it was really important for me to get a sense of how other people are experiencing the challenges of working reproducibly, because up to that point I thought all of my experiences were unique, which I basically tend to do. So it was literally transformative. I got a much better perspective of how other people are solving these problems or tackling them. And also the process of attending the workshop, I think most of us who were there and wrote most of the chapters in the period of the actual workshop, which was also another exciting sort of burst of productivity. It also felt to me personally like I was kind of writing a contract with myself. Like I've done this experiment with this one project, attempting to make it as reproducible as possible and struggling to see this new tools and ideas, and then I sort of lay awake at night and months out and thinking like, this is something I'm ever going to be able to do again. And all these other people, plenty of people in this workshop doing this routinely, or is this also a once-off thing for them that they sort of struggle to get to?
Yeah, ready. Go for it.
You can just click over here to show
that. Oh, thanks so much. Okay, so a couple of reflections. So I went from being a reproducibility, being a curiosity, to now being a debilitating obsession after being empowered by participating in this workshop, and from being a disgruntled reviewer,
Sort of complaining privately about how unreproducible things were, and now I'm very vocal. I think getting tenure was critical in that step. Now I'm very happy to speak out. In my professional organization, the Society of American Archaeology, we've just organized a open science interest group where we have a manifesto coming out shortly about, you know, scripting and version control and open data and so on. And I've also been quite happy to speak, be quite vocal about, you know, reproducibility in data science as a valuable thing in our academic community. This just came out today or yesterday with a couple of my colleagues in eScience at UW and just another guy off Twitter who, you know, uses R and is very interested in reproducible research. So in some ways, quite a sort of life-changing moment. So here's my, you can see it okay, I think, yeah.
Workflow diagram. We excavated an archaeological site in northern Australia that had been excavated a couple of times over the last 3 decades. It's very famous already. If we dug it a bit deeper, a bit bigger, we found more artifacts, and older ones.
And the analysis is very conventional. I'll just hide this out of the way while I... Very conventional analysis, but I tried to adopt this sort of reproducible tooling so that the data came in from our collaborators and spreadsheets and other things.
And I made an R package, a custom R package, and used these other sort of tools in the R ecosystem so that I could have this kind of push button reproducibility. So you can imagine this bit like an onion. There's a bit of R script, then there's the tooling of an R package, then I have a Docker image that is holding it all, so I've got sort of good protection in terms of my computational environment. And then these other bits and pieces that are sort of more or less familiar to doing a research project, shuffling around with a Word document, reviewing. We have other stakeholders in our project who have input and so on. But this is really the hub of it here, and this is what caused me to lose a lot of sleep. I sort of stitched together this thing, and it wasn't something I could ever do again. And I'm pleased to report to you now, a couple of years later, that almost every substantial research project I've done since that one has been in this mold. With minor, there's been a few dead ends and a bit of refinement, but basically, this sense of the R package as a research compendium has been extremely efficient and productive for me. And a couple of the other in the group and I are now, you know, being very active in promoting this way of organizing the research around the unit of the R package.
So that's been something that's been really transformative for me professionally as well. Okay, so the workflow diagram. A couple of really crucial parts. The book-down package enables cross-referencing for figures and tables and citations, the usual sort of scholarly writing apparatus, and now fully functional in R and R Markdown, and that just simplifies writing a sort of self-contained document with code and narrative text and citations and cross-references, now very simple. The Center for Open Science have produced an excellent sort of data repository and preprint service that I now use heavily and makes collaboration very easily. That's another crucial component of my sort of modern workflow since the time of our workshop and this initial first effort. The pain points, I think, as Kelly mentioned, other people, getting other people to sort of work in a way that's consistent with the way I'm working and get out of their spreadsheets and so on. That's a challenge. Dependencies in our packages are a major technical challenge. So in the course of this one project that is the case study, the ggplot2 package, which is a wonderful graphics package, had a major version change and crippled all of my plots, and it was really frustrating. So I'm now working on these two kind of solutions that PackRed is like storing the version of the package locally on my computer, and MRAN is a sort of snapshotted server of R packages, and I'm experimenting with both of those to try and solve this problem. This major headache for me still in trying to work reproducibly is keeping the packages as I like them. So the future for me, the challenges going forward, trying to get this more into my teaching and sort of persuading students, especially graduate students who are working with other faculty, my colleagues who are not working in the same way as me, that this is worth their effort. I'm having some success with that now, and as my work becomes more visible, especially the reproducible elements of it, it's easier to do that. And now I'm quite interested in building the interest group in my professional society, the Society of American Archaeology, to especially have some influence on the way editors in the journal are working. So we're looking at influencing scholarly publication, especially the badging system that the Center for Open Science have developed. We want to see more of that in our scholarly communication systems. So I feel like now I've settled on a very sustainable model for doing my research reproducibly, and now I just want to get everyone else doing it, or more or less like that. And so here's the sort of thing I'll probably get tattooed across my back shortly. The way I'm thinking about reproducible research and how I sort of want to teach it and do it and encourage other people to do it. This is the kind of conventional model here, the common or garden research paper, the advertisement as Deneau and Burkhardt famously described it. And then at the other end, the kind of thing that most of us are working towards, where we have a document or a compendium that includes code and the version control and data and narrative text and with some sort of persistent connections between them, like DOIs, repositories, and so on. So this is what I'm sort of seeing as a vision that I'd like my colleagues in archaeology to be working towards in the future. Thank you very much.
Hi, okay, so I'm Katie Huff. I'm a professor at the University of Illinois now in nuclear engineering, but I used to be here at BIDS. Books are great, right? They're great to read. And my experience with this particular book was that I read it before it was really ready so that I could synthesize it, so that other people don't necessarily have to read the whole thing. But I'll tell you that I think this experience brought me a great deal of empathy for all of the scientists around me, and I know that the community around me is trying to be as reproducible as possible. And I knew that before reading any of these case studies, but I think there was a lot more frank emotion in some of these case studies than I was truly expecting. And I felt deeply connected to people in domains very dissimilar from my own. And I think that was a really fun experience to read that and see the same lessons across a lot of domains. And so that's the majority of what this chapter is about, what kind of pain everyone was sharing, what kind of brilliant strokes of brilliance they had in the context of this journey. But basically, we're all climbing this same mountain of scientific reproducibility. And so maybe you're climbing the north face and I'm climbing the south face, but it's a very similar grade, lots of similar terrain. And we, I think, learn very similar things. So I'll talk about what we learned. So I'll tell you about the incentives that people expressed, their pain points, some of the recommendations that the case study authors had, and I'll give you a little data about it, and then some remaining needs. So the incentives, these are reasons that people wanted to do this across the board. I found very few other incentives than these seven. People really wanted to be more efficient, more successfully collaborate. They wanted to see their science being done in a way that could be extended by other scientists, and they really wanted to see verifiability. And I really liked some of these quotes at the bottom. Someone said they wanted to focus on science, and having a system around their code really helped them do that. Some felt that this was good force planning, and Ben mentioned this just now, actually, in the context of making sure things fit his previous mold, and a safety for evolution. So maybe you're the one extending your work later, and it gives you some safety if you know you can reproduce past work. And I thought that these really capture what everyone who submitted case studies falls into one of these incentive categories. But what hurt? What was our shared pain? There were so many pain points. And I would say, and both Ben and Kelly mentioned this, it was about people and skills. Where reproducibility broke down, it was typically some collaboration denominator that people didn't share all of the tools that they needed to in order for the tool stack to work properly, because there was someone who didn't know Git, or someone who didn't know LaTeX, or someone who preferred to work with word track changes and email stuff back and forth. And that's the nature of people and collaborations. A lot of people have problems with dependencies, build systems, packaging. They had trouble with accessing exactly the same hardware, or predicted that people trying to reproduce their work would have trouble accessing the same hardware. This ranged from HPC systems to MRI type machines that I don't know much about. Lots of people had trouble really incorporating testing into their work. We'll talk about that a bit. You know, publishing as a collective seemed to be like a real pain point, especially with this emailing back and forth issue. And data versioning. No one knows how to version their data. This, honestly, there are industry tools for it, but I don't think that we've converged as, you know, a technical, on a technical solution for data versioning. There are many technical solutions, but I think very few people would agree on a best practice for data versioning. It's coming, but scientists definitely don't have a strong way to figure out how to version their data. Now, version control of code is a different story, just to be clear. I'm talking about versioning the data. And also people didn't feel they had enough time and to be reproducible, and their data was often very restricted. So those were the pain points. And all of the authors had recommendations along the same sort of lines that I would have guessed going into this. And, you know, it's stuff that's already been mentioned actually by all of the case study authors that came up here. Use open tools, try to version control your code, use documentation, automate things. You know, don't hand enter data, because that's going to be a step that you can't reproduce. So if you can avoid it, try not to do this or that. You know, and people typically made these recommendations after failing to do one of these things. And so the case studies are very humorous in this way. People, sort of, as scientists, are very good at self-reflection in a very honest fashion. I think it's very nice to see. Now, there's other recommendations that I don't think were as universally shared, but were noted enough by a few people that I think are worth mentioning here. Avoiding excessive dependencies, right? This is the answer to having the pain point of having too many dependencies, or at least package their installation so there's a one-click option. That takes a lot of work. It takes software engineering, which is not a skill that we are typically taught as scientists. Software engineering is pretty far from scientific domain learning. But packaging their installation requires some software engineering. Use GitHub, get DOIs, digital object identifiers, for archival persistence of both your data and your code. So digital object identifiers are just like that weird number that you see on your journal article, and it's always going to point to that article. The same thing can be done for code. So get those. Plain text data is preferred because it is a timeless format. You can always understand text data, you know, if it's an Excel XS type of format, then you're actually talking about folders upon folders of XML files on the back end of that kind of binary file. It's very hard to version, but text is timeless. Explicitly set pseudo-random seeds. So rather than just expect that you'll remember like which seed and it's in the code, just like explicitly set them in your code as part of your reproducibility, so you get the same pseudo-random numbers generated every time. A couple of these, I should note, actually very explicit ones are from the Stark Ottoboni Milman case study. Workflow frameworks are often very useful, but they can be overkill. So a lot of people who tried frameworks in which to plop their science that were supposed to give them a deal of reproducibility found them clunky, right? That's not to say that it's not worth pursuing, you know, workflow frameworks that could be a great home for just science you want to pop, but real frameworks around reproducing your code is typically, or reproducing your science is, a lot of people found them not quite right for their specific action, and so it felt clunky. And there were some people who had recommendations that most other people did not agree with. So these are all individuals. And so I'm going to just bring up two of these quotes that I thought were unique and have a more maybe practical experience of reproducibility that I don't necessarily agree with. But, you know, this case study, I don't want to embarrass anyone, but, you know, this case study author really points out, you know, actually, you know, we may have had some errors in our scripts because we didn't really test it. And so anyone trying to reproduce our work should probably not rely on our scripts, right? And that's valid in many, many ways. Is it reproducibility? Not in the computational reproducibility sense, but yes, in the science sense. So there are subtleties that you run into in these case studies where you say, wait, that statement is about being the opposite of reproducible. But if you think about it, you know, it's actually coming from a very natural place from science and wants to seek to avoid error. This outlier, scientific funding and the number of scientists available to do the work is finite. And therefore, not every scientific result can or should be reproduced. Right? So ask yourself, which ones do you reproduce? Probably the ones you're going to publish. Do you reproduce every prototype effort? No. And should you? Probably not. Not if you ever want to get anything done. Now, if you have a system in your work that's always going to allow you to reproduce everything, that's so much better because you can effortlessly capture every task that you do. But, you know, if you crack open a Jupyter notebook and try a thing or two, maybe it doesn't have to be the most reproducible thing in the universe. Like, yeah, you should put it on GitHub and now it's almost reproducible, but should you put in hours and hours upon time making sure it's got unit tests and stuff? Maybe not, right? Maybe not for every result. And I think, you know, you'll read some of these alternative sort of thoughts that should get you thinking in this book. Right, so there's a lot of popular tools. Anything that was listed more than a couple times, I, you know, called out. There's a lot of Jupyter use, a lot of GitHub, a lot of Python, a lot of LaTeX. This isn't surprising, right? These tools are really the core, like, and are. They're really the core of reproducibility. You know, you're relying on open source libraries and open source tools, and you're putting it all up on GitHub. Python was really popular, R was really popular, there's some Java and C++. Daniel put another more beautiful graph up, so I won't go into this. But what I'll say that I did find that there was a distinction between people who use R and people who use Python in terms of whether or not tests were present in their workflow. And I think it's something to note that Python has numerous testing libraries. You can write a unit test in Python in many different ways using many different tools. Whereas R only has, like, to my knowledge, one testing library. So it was less common to see in that domain. I'm not saying R users don't test their code. I'm just saying these R users typically didn't test their code as much. And so it'd be, and there was more, so just to note, sure, there were fewer R users, but it's worth noting that of them, you have tests versus no tests. And if you look closely, you have this sort of difference. Python users were much more likely to write tests. Without going into everything, this chapter about lessons learned actually goes through all kinds of stuff that maybe we need to look towards in the future that could fix reproducibility as an experience for the scientists so that we can climb that mountain with a little less pain. And a couple I'll just call out is that, you know, we should maybe understand why people choose to do unit testing so that we can increase the number of people who test their code, because it was a smaller number than I predicted among this group of scientists who were trying to be reproducible. So we should figure out, I think, why people test their code and make sure that that incentive is clear to all scientists. We should do some adoption around publication formats that allow parallel editing so that more people will put their LaTeX up on GitHub rather than emailing Word documents back and forth, because it causes a lot of frustration. You know, data storage, versioning, and management tools should be better adopted, and we should adopt maybe file format standards within certain domains. That was a common complaint, that a domain didn't have a particular file format standard, and people didn't know how to store their data. So that's all I had to say, and I should add, I really got a lot, you know, I didn't write this chapter on my own, I got a lot of feedback from other authors, and especially from the editor, so there you go.
Yeah, so I had the fun job of both writing a chapter about my case study, but also kind of synthesizing all the themes from the book with Ben Marwick in a chapter where we tried to look at themes similar to what Katie brought up, but in a much more broader sense. We didn't sort of get into the nitty-gritty details. And so I'm not going to get into, like, all the details from the chapter itself, but I wanted to bring three different themes that we were interested in addressing. And those are sort of the gaps that exist in the different types of workflows that we have, looking at some of the challenges that we could address going into the future. And then there are some opportunities for people that are involved in this whole research lifecycle. And so one of the big things that came about is that in the past decade, sort of the line between someone being a research software engineer and sort of a traditional domain scientist have just become very, very blurry. So most of us are doing sort of domain science, but we're also writing a lot of code, we're pulling together algorithms, we're cleaning up data. So we're doing a lot of these different types of activities. And we're having access to a lot of different types of data these days. And so new kinds of hardware, new kinds of software have given us access to a ton of data that we can use to work on a whole bunch of different problems, like climate change until some executive order bans research on that, things like disease outbreaks, drug discovery, and so on. And so one of the biggest challenges, which Katie brought up, is that we're relying on a diversity of hardware and a diversity of software and gluing them together in very crappy ways. And so this could be somebody's workflow, and for you to take this, understand it, and reuse it is very, very hard. And one particular challenge is that there's lots of different gaps. So we don't quite understand how data flows out of one piece of hardware or one piece of software can be readily used at the next step. And so on top of gaps like this in the software and hardware itself, there's also this big challenge with training. So Katie brought up things like some people might use version control, some others might not. And so there are challenges with having access to this kind of training, which programs like Software and Data Carpentry are trying to address. And taking somebody's workflow and trying to reuse some part of that in your own research can be very, very challenging, and sometimes the outcome is not so great. And so a lot of these gaps are slowly being addressed by better tooling. So anybody here use Jupyter Notebooks? Anybody heard of it? Okay, a few people. And so a lot of these different pieces of software that we're trying to use are now much easier, are now linked together in a much easier way with literate programming frameworks like Jupyter Notebooks and then R Studio and R Markdown for the R people. And the other point that I wanted to make while talking about gaps is that it's very hard to do very good reproducible research. So it's not just simply a matter of dropping your code and data somewhere and then letting someone else pick that up. And so the challenge that comes with that is the challenge of incentives. So publications are still the currency in this game, and anybody that spends their time doing sort of these good practices or adopting these good practices are not yet rewarded. And so there's a lot of different work in this space with projects like impact story tracking, sort of the metrics from all of this. But we also looked at sort of what is the tangible benefit to sharing your data, sharing your code, things like that. And so in the chapter, we talk a little bit about how does sharing data with your paper increase your citation, increase the visibility of your research, and so on. And so I encourage you to go check out that section of the chapter, but also this other paper that came out after we wrote the chapter on sort of these different benefits that come from being an open scientist. And then the last bit of our chapter, we sort of go over some of the opportunities to make reproducible research more of a norm going into the future. And there are three particular areas in which we can improve or encourage these practices among researchers. And one of them is from funders. And so at least with Moore and Sloan, which funds the Data Science Institute and various projects like Jupyter, R/OpenSci, and many others, there's potential to ask researchers to deposit their code, to deposit their Jupyter notebooks and their data. And so a lot of change can come about that way. A second opportunity is for folks like the research librarians to kind of address these problems that span different silos. And so things related to challenges in reproducibility, data archiving, data sharing is something that even folks like Research IT and Aaron could help address. And then the last opportunity is for journal editors and journals to sort of help out. And so a couple of journals that I'd like to point out as very contrived examples are the ReScience Journal, which actually, where you submit a paper that has already been published as a replication effort. And only when an editor can actually hit make and rebuild a paper will we publish that paper. So if you cannot replicate all the statistical results, the tables and the figures, nothing gets published. And then the Journal of Open Source Software, where we sort of submit publications around software, but until someone can install it, run it, and actually use it, and look for tests and documentation, no one is actually going to publish that. But more traditional journals can also ask authors to make their code publicly available, their data publicly available, to sort of encourage these different pieces to come together. So it's not all doom and gloom. We end the chapter in a very positive note that the ecosystem of tools are emerging and getting better integrated. Jupyter works with other things. All these different tools are working together. And the incentive mechanisms are also slowly falling in place. It's not perfect, but federal funders now are okay with reporting products besides publications. And there's better ways now to track all of these different kinds of outputs. So go read the paper, go grab a copy of the book, buy one for your family. With that, I'll hand it back to Justin.
While they're getting set up, I just want to say for anyone who did come in at the last minute, I want to mention again the URL where you can find the book. It is practicereproducibleresearch.org. So if you want to read the whole book, again, if you weren't here at the beginning, practicereproducibleresearch.org, that's the imperative form in the URL, as in you should practice reproducible research, not the descriptive, as in the title. And then while people are sort of getting set up, we're going to bring out some chairs in a second. I'll also say one more reflection to kind of get started that comes back a little bit from some of the things that some of the other folks have said. One of the threads that ran throughout the whole process of writing this book from all of the authors, the case studies and the core authors, was the discussion or the debate about whether working reproducibly made you faster or slower. And you could imagine a lot of the implications of the take-home messages depend to some degree on whether you think ultimately working reproducibly makes you faster or slower at your work. And I don't think there was actually any strong consensus on that. People felt both ways. They felt that in some cases it was ultimately making them more efficient. They felt in some cases it was wasted effort. And which side ultimately that comes down on in the long run, I think personally is probably quite an important question that emerged from working on this book. Any questions for us? Any thoughts?
Someone has to ask a question.
Yeah, and there are microphones for people asking questions.
First of all, just many thanks for this entire session. It's a blast. Question. What can we do at scientific societies specifically, and this came up, there was a mention of this in the talk, but specifically at conferences, right? If we get societies in a place where we push for helping scientists to do reproducible research, we could run workshops. What are things we could do in an hour or two in a workshop at an academic society to just give best practices to the researchers?
I can mention something that the Organization for Human Brain Mapping is doing already, which is handing out an award for the reproduction of a study. So a paper that comes out with a reproduction of a study is eligible for an award. It's a few thousand dollars. This is actually, the authors of a couple of the chapters in this book are actually the initiators of this. This is Chris Gorgolewski and Russ Poldrack from Stanford are initiating this, or some of the people initiating this.
So a related thing that I'm involved in archaeology, so many of you are familiar with software carpentry and data carpentry and the two-day workshops they run. So we've condensed them down into a four-hour program that we're going to run at the annual meeting of the Society of American Archaeology. And we're also having so that's an extracurricular activity that we're using to promote the idea of reproducibility. And a related activity we're doing is having a regular academic scheduled event. So there's, you know, conference, like paper presentations, and there's another event called a forum, which is more like a discussion. We're using the forum event to do code demos of stuff that archaeologists have coded for publication, but the focus is going to be on running the code and showing how you can solve certain archaeological problems using our code. So that's another kind of training event to show how you can do things in a reproducible way, but in a sort of traditional academic format through this conference forum. And another thing that we're doing with this open science interest group, so that's an obvious thing that can be done at any professional society, is to organize a section or a committee or an interest group that is specifically focused on reproducibility and open science. And the one that I'm leading for archaeology is directly inspired by Andrew McDonald, is that his name? The Ecological Society of America, he instituted one there, and I just copied what he did for archaeology. I think anyone can do that for their own thing. But one thing we're going to do is to take the Center for Open Science badging, which is designed for journal articles and journal editors to administer. We're going to administer it within our society for the conferences. So people who want to present a poster or a slide deck as a paper, they can have our interest group review it for one of the open data or open materials badges and then display those badges on their poster or on their slide deck to sort of visibly communicate their commitment to reproducibility. So I think these are kind of things that are, you know, broadly applicable, sort of transdisciplinary, that not specific to archaeology. Any discipline can implement these kind of things at a sort of meeting level or society level. And I think the level of interest that I've received in doing this in archaeology has been really very heartwarming. And I expect you would all enjoy a similar reception in your research communities as well.
I would like to add something actually to this. We have been discussing this a lot in the Reproducibility workshop at BITS before even this book came up, how we can like educate people to do reproducible science, right? And not, you don't even have to go to conferences, right, to get that. We are at the university, we're at the core of this. We are here to teach these practices. And one of the things that we talked about was, is in a similar lines, like what Ben is describing, is to have like a kind of like a workshop type of reproducible practices workshop. This book is probably like a good, I don't know, first start for handing you something over. But it turned out in the discussions that we had that this is a harder problem if you want to put that in a sentence of like a workshop or one day of workshop, like software carpentry or data carpentry type of workshop. Yet I do think it can be parts of it can be done, and Ben just told us that it is possible to do it, which is great. So I think we should just make this happen more and more, just in the universities and then maybe in the conferences as well.
So I also want to make sure we get to others. So if you have one more thought, and then I'll see if there are other questions.
Sure. So one other comment I want to make is you know data carpentry and those folks. So if anybody wants to get involved in this particular project, please do. So Data Carpentry and my team are trying to build these short lesson modules on things like Zoomnodo, how to deposit data, how to use Figshare, how to set up a makefile for your research, things like that, as very short topics that are well documented and maintained by a bunch of people that, let's say you're attending a conference and you'd like to do a little workshop, you can kind of mix and match different topics that you think might be of interest and go teach that. And we're hoping to build out sort of this nice menu of topics and make that available to all these different societies. Awesome. We can talk about protocols, we can talk about other fun stuff.
Are there other questions? Yeah, we'll get you a microphone.
As some of you mentioned, publishing is, at least in academia, sort of the name of the game. Have you started to see any motion or shifting forward progress about concerns about reproducibility, questions, rewards for it, feedback from reviewers? Like, has there been any motion in that direction, really, beyond like journals that are specifically designed for that, right? So in the journals that are not specifically open.
I'll say that I do know of a few, and myself included, individuals who choose to take it upon themselves to explicitly reject papers that don't have enough information to build the code or don't have any citation of their data. You know, I have this list that's, I think Lorena Barba is responsible for the PI reproducibility manifesto. There's other lists of this kind of thing. And I think you can make your own list, and I've sort of made my own list of things that I really want to see in a paper to guarantee reproducibility. But it's stuff like that. Like, is there a DOI for the data? And it's a little grassroots, and some editors really hate to then assign you papers after some time of this. But I think that's where it needs to start. But Ariel, I think you had a thought.
Yeah, I was recently asked to remove links to code from a paper. So there, it goes in all directions, right?
My feeling is that I'm seeing more, as a peer reviewer, more papers that have code like in it or related, mention code. I don't know if that's a real effect or just because I'm always banging on at the editors that we should have more papers with code. And so when they get a paper with code, it automatically goes to me because they know I'm obsessed about it. So I'm not sure how objective my measure is. But my feeling is that it is becoming more pervasive, especially in my field. Scripting is starting to increase in popularity over sort of point-and-click analyses. And I'm also noticing personally that if I do a talk somewhere on my campus at UW for like a center, like the Center for Statistics and Social Sciences, and I talk for them maybe once every 2 years over the sort of 8 or 9 years I've been there. And the first couple of talks, not many people there, not much interest. They're mostly about, you know, open science and reproducibility. The last one was packed, and then I had 4 or 5 requests, like, we couldn't make it to your talk. Can you come to our lab group and tell us about this reproducibility stuff in fields that I don't know anything about? And so I figure that there's kind of a momentum behind these concerns now broadly in many areas of science.
I would add, at the risk of inventing something, so maybe someone up here could verify, I believe that Nature Publishing Group has just added an explicit statement in their submission process that you are supposed to include all code as supplementary information. That's the latest one that I'd seen. And I think Harold had a question.
So how do you separate reproducibility as a way to learn tools, gain experience, and see how other people have done their research from the opposing view that you want to reproduce something somebody did because you want to check the integrity of that person? You want to write a comment where you want to take that person and the results apart.
That's hard. I have
an anecdote. I don't know if it answers the question, but the paper that I talked about, we actually, the plus one where we published this paper, has the possibility of asking questions in comments on the paper. We got a question that was sort of a little bit vague. This was actually a researcher that I know and asked a simple question about this. And we had then the opportunity to say, okay, you're asking a question about the characteristics of the distribution of the noise and how that affects this. Here's a set of notebooks that shows you what we did. You want to pick us apart? Let's, you know, show us what you want. What exactly do you want us? What is it that you want to pick apart here? Can we have a discussion? Instead of having the discussion in vague terms, can we have this in concrete terms? Here's code, here's data, let's talk. I think it elevates the conversation because now you know exactly what you're talking about.
A piece of that question, I think, though, is sort of related to fear of being exposed. And this is something I think that comes up when we talk to a lot of people. I think we've all heard it when talking to other folks about reproducibility is, scientists who are genuinely afraid either of having made a mistake, and they sort of fear that they've made a mistake and don't want to be exposed just in case they had, and being open and reproducible is a way for someone else to more rapidly find the mistake that you may or may not have made. I'm in ecology, environmental science, and there's also folks who want to make themselves the smallest target as possible to shoot at in general. They feel a somewhat political, not maybe literally political, but political incentive to provide a small target area, and providing all of your data and code makes you a larger target. I think as Katie was saying, I think those are real concerns. They're natural concerns. And you can't do anything other than weigh them against the corresponding benefits. But I know I've heard that several times.
So I want to make a comment that addresses Rachel's question and your comment together. So one thing is that it is very grassroots. So the two journals I mentioned are very, very contrived sort of for the purpose of verifying things. At least anecdotally, we're slowly trying to change this by getting people like Katie to be a reviewer or like someone I know who knows how to use GitHub. And so I'm slowly starting to see that change even within my own community of people that I went to grad school with that hated code and then suddenly are tweeting about a paper and then I can see a link to a GitHub repo. And I'm just like, you know what GitHub means. Like, this is amazing. Like, we've reached a certain kind of crowd. So I think that is slowly permeating. But before I lose my train of thought, since I'm talking about three different things, anecdotally, someone I know published a paper in bioinformatics where one of the comments was, why didn't you try this other approach? But both reviewers were quite familiar with all the tools involved because they're computational biologists. And so this person told them, clone our Git repo, check out this branch. We tried that. We didn't really like that direction. And the paper was accepted within a couple of days because they were quite happy with everything. They were able to check everything out. And so there's that potential for finding a reviewer that is versed in the same things that you know. But to finally hit Justin's comment, someone recently pointed out to me that even though there is the fear of being exposed, it's actually like your best defense against, in good faith, I have done everything. So here's all my code, all my data, everything else. And if you publish this, it's now your failure to verify that I did the job correctly. Like I've shown everything. The reviewers could have seen everything and rejected it. And so there's that defense, which some people have communicated to me.
I think we have time for one more question. So maybe we'll get someone in the middle there who hasn't asked one yet. And we'll be around afterwards. If any of you have other questions you wanted to chat about, we'll be around for a few minutes afterwards also.
Yeah, maybe this is kind of a scoping question, but it does touch on some of the larger issues of what after reproducibility. As I understand it, this book doesn't cover any particular actual reproductions of work. So what are some of the issues there in terms of do you have the neurocognitions and the economists swap ostensibly reproducible papers? What are some of the criteria that you would use to try and anticipate dealing with first order complaints about who's ever going to bother to reproduce these things? We just charge ahead in terms of benefits and pain points.
I don't know, I'd say the goal of the book was primarily to show what people are doing so they can investigate. But, you know, and what you're presenting is, you know, a great idea for another activity. And what would you then do? And I think actually the model of these journals that Karthik has been mentioning, so like that JOS, for example, on which I'm a subject editor and a few of us are sitting here, the activity is very much that you find someone who understands the methodology and attempts to, you know, build the code, check the abilities of the code, and there's a specific checklist of things that you check, just whether or not it's going to run, and does it make the plot that they say it's going to make, and, you know, does it have a class that does the thing that it's supposed to do. I don't think that it would be such a great idea to have an economist try to do it for a typical bioinformatics paper, because it might get I think you have to address it at such a high level if you don't understand the methodology that you might get a positive, like, oh yes, this is reproducible. You would get a lot of false positives in terms of reproducibility, I think, in that case, because I think sometimes the reproducibility, you have to understand the method a little better to know what you're reproducing to really investigate. That would be my answer to that like, if you just swap domains, it might not be as robust.
Yeah, I think the future is in like disciplinary specific reproducibility, and so we've seen a couple of disciplines, journals appointing reproducibility editors, like the American Statistical Association, where someone who's like expert in the domain, also expert with computational tools, is tasked with assessing the reproducibility of papers. And I think that's the logical step forward after this kind of broad survey of what people are doing and the problems they're facing, is then for us to go into our own disciplines and sort of fertilize the practice of reproducibility and have reproducibility reviews within our own field, because we have the domain expertise to sort of see how it works very efficiently rather than struggling with all the overhead of the domain as well as the computational stuff. So I think that's what I see as the next few steps.
I would like to give maybe a practical example to this and how this can, like, I'm also in the idea of like domain specific. And even like if you go from the domain to the specific lab, how you make sure that your things in the lab are reproducible and it's not only on the hand of your collaborators and yourself, is basically that maybe within the lab already you can start letting other people who are not involved in your project or in your student's project to try to use their either own pipelines. Usually in a lab it should be a standard pipeline, but this is how research goes. Like in the lab already there's like few other versions of the same code or same type of code. So ask the other student to replicate the results and don't publish before that, right? I think that's a very simple, practical possibility. How to start again in a small scale so we can spread.
Yeah, and just a larger scale. And to broaden that out a little bit and then take us to a conclusion for the formal part at least, you know, I think what Fatma was talking about, a lot of the questions touch on this idea of community norms. You know, in principle at least, you know, academic science is somewhat self-governing in that we decide collectively as a community what we think is appropriate and what we're willing to publish and what we're willing to review and what we think is appropriate to do. And a lot of the questions around journal publication, reviews, how you get incentives, I think a lot of them really at the bottom come down to the question of, do we collectively decide that being able to independently verify each other's work is important? Now, Philip Stark, who's not here, would say, of course it's important, and it's been important since the 1600s when we had the modern idea of science come out. And there's something to be said for that. There's something to be said for the fact that it seems logical that we should all be able to independently check each other's work. And I think a lot of the discussion centers around this idea of how do we develop a culture or a set of norms that require some aspects of that to the comfort of our fields or something to that effect. So I don't want to go too far past the time. I did want to say one more thing, which is we are actually continuing to collect additional case studies. We're not sure where we're going to publish them exactly, but if you were excited by anything you heard, please come up and find one of us after, and we will actually give you some instructions for how you could write up and submit a case study for your research if you were interested. So with that, thank you all very much for coming. Thank, of course, to all the co-authors and co-editors for all their efforts. And again, we appreciate seeing you here. Thanks very much.